Hi, I'm Eric Friesen. Welcome to the fourth chapter in my history of the National Arts Center Orchestra. This one is all about the most recent decade of the orchestra, the fourth decade, the Pinchas years. One of the huge bonuses that comes with having Pinchas Zukerman as a music director is that you also get a world-class virtuoso player. Night after concert night, Pinchas not only leads the National Arts Center Orchestra, but he plays with it, as he's doing here, playing Mozart, January 3rd, 2003. Pinchas has been music director since 1998, taking firm artistic control of the orchestra. And in a way, this has been the culmination of a long and cordial relationship. It's like when an old friendship suddenly flares into a love affair after many years. Pinchas has been coming to play and conduct the National Arts Center Orchestra since 1976. He took the orchestra on a memorable tour to Europe in 1990. After a decade of challenges, things were now looking up at the NAC. Now was the right time for a star music director here, and it was the right time for Pinchas. Many of you will know Pinchas as one of the greatest living violinists and violists on the planet. His friend and frequent collaborator, the pianist Yefim Bronfman, remembers the very first time he heard Pinchas. Fima, as he's known, had just emigrated to Israel from the Soviet Union.
I remember the first time I heard Pinchas Zukerman play in Tel Aviv. I just immigrated. I was 14 or 15 years old, and my parents took me to Israel for a money concert. And there was this violinist I never heard of, Pinchas Zukerman. What kind of name is that? You know, must be a local violinist. He was 24, 25, you know, he's exactly 10 years older than me. And he played Beethoven concerto with Zubin Mehta conducting, you know, and I, you know, when I heard the performance, I nearly fell off my seat. It was so, first of all, it was impeccable, and to produce the most beautiful sound that one hears from this instrument. It was just an amazing performance, and that's how I heard him for the first time. I didn't meet him then, but I swear to you that I said, I've got to play with this person one of these days. You know, I've heard people say that he was born with violin. You know, he's a natural, most natural player that there is. You know, you cannot imagine the kind of admiration people have him for him in the world as a violinist. People regard him as the greatest violinist in the world, which I agree. I think he's the greatest violinist in the world, no question about it.
And not a bad violist either.
And, you know, now that he's of age, he's revered as the godfather of violin playing. This is a title that used to belong to Heifetz and to Menuhin and Stern. And, you know, now this next generation, I think he's the, when you hear, when I mentioned to somebody in London or in Prague that I know Pinchas Zukerman, I said, really? You know him personally? I mean, he's really a great presence, especially in the world of violin. You know, all violinists look up to him. That's a sure thing.
That's pianist Yefim Bronfman. But Pinchas has always been about being more than a great violinist. He had long been interested in conducting. He had developed early on a relationship with the English Chamber Orchestra. Then he was music director of the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra from 1980 to 1987. It's a period I remember very well. I was living in St. Paul, Minneapolis at the time. And then Pinchas left. He left the Twin Cities, and he took a break from running an orchestra for a while. And maybe about 6-7 years later, in the mid-90s, he began having serious conversations with the board of the Dallas Symphony Orchestra about becoming their music director. He'd been approached to replace Eduardo Mata, who had died in a plane crash in early 1995. And Pinchas explains what happened when he began his conversations with Dallas Symphony Board Chairman Morton Meyerson.
So I went there and I said to them, this is what I need, this is what I think you should do. and we needed some education, a whole bunch of stuff. Everybody said, well, come, you know, when you come, sign a dotted line, you know, everything will work. I said, Mort, I'm not doing that. I spent a whole day with him one day, a great guy. And we talked about everything but the Dallas Symphony, you know, what we can do. And, you know, Schulte was there and Kletsky, a great history. And not to speak of Marcus. I mean, he was an incredible man with a vision that really saved the orchestra in the 50s. So I thought, well, this is good. You know, this can work. And well, he brought all of that to the board at large. And he called me up in typical Texas fashion. He said, I don't think you should show up in town again. I said, Mort, what happened? He said, I don't know, it took about 25 minutes, and I think you better not show up again. Anyway.
Because you demanded too much?
Well, I think they just couldn't deal with it. Maybe it's too much for some people, but the vision was just too big at that time, I suppose.
So, Pinchas scared Dallas with his grand vision of a 10-year plan for education, orchestra development, technology, and the Dallas possibility disappeared. Suddenly, Pinchas was free.
I had no psychological or musical connection to another orchestra. And it felt pretty good. You know, I felt, wow, this is opening the window. I can breathe. And not that I didn't want to be in Dallas, but it would have been a tremendous undertaking, which I was willing to do because it was a fantastic instrument. I mean, the Dallas Symphony, it was amazing. It was like a Lamborghini. It was phenomenal. I mean, Eduardo just, oh, it was great. So, and we had great chemistry, and it was wonderful. So I then came back here at that point. I hadn't been here for about 6 or 7 years for different reasons. I liked what I saw. I liked what I felt. And as Dick Sizek said, you see, we have a way of getting you back into that podium as music director. And they kind of came after me a little bit. I laid down, again, what I thought we should do. Size of orchestra, education, and, of course, technology. And I didn't hear a no from anybody. And I thought, well, this is not bad. Maybe we'll give it a chance, you know. See if we can go somewhere together. The city had grown tremendously. I was rather despondent with what was happening in the States at the time.
What was happening in the States?
Well, the music directorships. I felt a lot of people, and it wasn't just me. It was just so hard to put through any kind of artistic endeavor. It cost so much money, and all the rules and regulations, I just didn't want to deal with it anymore.
And it was different here?
Yeah.
How?
It was an orchestra in flux. The center is different. Of course, I didn't know what I know today. And maybe if I'd known that, what I know now, I would have said, bye-bye, adios, see you, you know, au revoir. But no, it's a terrific place because it has a certain significance. The idea that it's the art center of a country. And I think we've done so far very well with it.
It's so interesting to me that Pinchas was too extravagant for Dallas, but not too extravagant for Ottawa. Ottawa was ready to embrace him, and all kudos to the management of the time, board chairman Jean-Thérèse Riley and chief executive John Crippton, who had the courage and the largeness of vision to appoint Pinchas Zukerman. Pinchas's appointment as music director in April 1998 made a big splash. Music lovers in Ottawa were thrilled. Evelyn Greenberg speaks for them.
Well, I thought, you know, if dreams come true. I remember when Pinchas first came here, he played and conducted many, many years ago. He was very young. And there was a small reception for him afterwards. And I remember saying to him, oh, I wish you had played more, because we didn't know him as a conductor. And he said, oh, I'll play. And I know the orchestra, I mean, they were in awe. Naturally, you could see the string players staring at him in the cadenza. And I wished for it because I thought, well, here's a man with a huge heart. I had met him several times. And, you know, he's like sometimes a gruff Winnie the Pooh teddy bear, but deep down inside, he's got a huge heart. You have to play like that. And I was hoping that a person of that persona, with a lot of warmth inside, he would be good for our orchestra, and our orchestra would be good for him. And I thought Ottawa would be good for Pinchas as well. I dare to say that, because we're very down to earth here. You know, we're not the New York elite. I thought this would be good for him. I mean, he's one of the foremost violinists in the world. And
violist.
I was just going to say, probably the foremost violist on the planet.
Ottawa music lover and longtime National Arts Center Orchestra supporter, Evelyn Greenberg. Now, the critics also were thrilled. Le Droit's Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler.
I was very happy that one could bring in one of the absolute stars. You know, there are about 10 people in the world. There are many other musicians and soloists that are at that level, but there is a little group of musicians which, you know, this is part of this world also. And bring in an absolute violin player and alto
and viola.
Viola player. I mean, this is, there are two, I mean, in my opinion, there are two viola players in the world at that level, and that's the, and he's the other one. So,
yeah.
For me also, I thought that his idea of chamber music and his playing of chamber music is top level. This Ottawa, when he came in, I said Ottawa is going to get great chamber music playing.
Music critic and Carleton University academic Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler. Well, what about the players in the orchestra? I mean, what did they think? Pace Sturtevant, who was principal trumpet at the time, was not surprised. He knew Pinchas was keeping his eye on them and that the musicians were keeping an eye on Pinchas.
But for me, it was meant to happen, and it wasn't a surprise. It certainly was. I thought it was the perfect transition after Trevor.
Why?
Because the quality of the orchestra had not been diminished, and we'd survived. And the orchestra is, I guess, we are a group of survivors if you look at the history. And it was worth and worthy of Pinchas, and another conductor who was a performer.
Why is that a good thing?
For me, on a personal level, is you learn so much from watching a conductor perform as a musician. It's, you learn how they think, so you understand when they ask for something, you know where it's coming from. Pinchas, he can walk into an orchestra and size up the string section just in a matter of minutes. And, you know, that kind of knowledge as a conductor on the podium. It's intimidating for some musicians and some orchestras, but the incredible expertise he brings, just the performance aspect. It sounds better if you do it this way. If you do it this way, it's more generic to either the time or the composer. Or the composers. It's more idiomatic.
Pace Sturtevant. Now, he mentioned how Pinchas coming to the National Arts Center Orchestra was intimidating to some of the players. And that was certainly true of the veteran violinist Elaine Clamasco.
Oh, complete intimidation. Just, I mean, you know, this had been somebody I had idolized for my life. And, I mean, to think of him as coming in as a conductor, but being able to look down the section and to see, you know, my inadequacies as a violinist, whether it be something in the bow arm, a shift, or I was terrified, absolutely terrified. But after that tour in 1990, when we went on tour with him, I realized that he wasn't that kind of a person. He sees everything. He misses nothing.
I know.
That's absolutely, he can sit here and tell you how every single member of this orchestra plays, what their strong points are, what their weak points are. He's looking. And not as a policeman. He's looking because he wants to make it as good as he can. But I was really nervous when I...
And how did it go, the first couple of rehearsals and concerts?
Well, I can't remember. I don't have a strong memory of anything being negative, that's for sure. It took me a little while to get over looking at this good-looking superstar in front of me, realizing that he too was also a human being, right, besides being the greatest violinist in the world, in my opinion, you know. So that took a little time to sort of come down to earth and work with him as a colleague, shall I say, you know.
Violinist Elaine Clamasco. Pinchas Zukerman, leading the National Arts Center Orchestra, playing the viola this time, as he does so brilliantly. That was the slow movement from a concerto by Georg Philipp Telemann. I'm Eric Friesen. You're listening to part four of my series on the history of the National Arts Center Orchestra. And we're in the most recent decade, the Pinchas years. So, Pinchas came to Ottawa to be music director in 1998. Not only did he take the job, he moved here. He moved to Ottawa, and he became firmly rooted in the city.
Well, I wanted to move somewhere for part of the time, for part of the year, outside the United States. And I was looking at possibly Europe, maybe some other places in the world, without any real connection, musical connection, just to live somewhere else for a while. But as it always turns out professional world, some personal as well, things come to me somehow. I didn't look for a place to live here, but it somehow came around. When Amanda and I became entangled, it was obvious. And so I was already being separated anyway from my previous marriage, so things seemed natural. And as you know, I know this country for a very long time. I have a tremendous warmth inside my tummy, you know, about this country. And specifically because my parents my father couldn't get a green card in the States back when they came in 63, 64. And after 2 years, they moved to Montreal. So I know the country through my own growing up and evolution of what's happened, you know, between what happened in Montreal, that all went to Toronto in the 60s, late 60s, and, of course, friends like Walter Homburger and so on.
Pinchas Zukerman, who has embraced Ottawa and Canada just as it welcomed his parents 40 years ago and which is now home to him and his wife, Amanda Forsyth, who's the principal cellist of the National Arts Center Orchestra. And I can tell you, I've known Pinchas for a long time. He doesn't say things to be nice. He's a truth teller. He means what he says. He says what he means, and you can hear it in his voice when he talks about his love for Canada. And he brought with him his ambitious program, the program that was too much for Dallas, and set about to implement it, expanding the orchestra in size and repertoire, touring, exploiting new technologies, and education, education, education. Pinchas is a big engine. He's always pushing to do more. He puts it this way.
I mean, if you come to a stop sign in a car, you have a choice. You either stay at that red light and just dream, or you see green, you go, oh, wow, I can go here and I can go there. And that's it. And so I always have seen the peripheral to some extent. Sometimes it got me in a hell of a lot of trouble. But I'm still here, you know? And I think the proof of the pudding, so to speak, is the 10 years that we have really done some amazing stuff. And we'll continue to do. This will stay forever. Our education program is second to none. In a sense of not only the center, but as an orchestra and what we have derived at in teaching and the ability to give young people the knowledge, I think is a duty of every person that feels that they can offer something. It's a duty.
But Pinchas, you don't approach it as a duty, because I've seen you in education. It's probably the thing that gives you the most pleasure in your life is teaching.
No, I don't mean duty for myself. I mean as a concept. Uh-huh. It's our obligation, I should say,
right,
to give back or to tell the younger generation or those younger colleagues of what I don't know, you know. And if I know, hey, take it. But what I don't know is what's interesting, because you then see how much you can absorb from that young person and their ability to absorb what you might be able to give them. And so, as you know, I love talent. Talent is the greatest thing, invention of all time. Because it's layers and layers of ability in thinking, in physical, eye-hand coordination, in all sorts of spheres that we only see if we spend time working with that youngster, you know, somebody that can really play. And what a pleasure it is to see someone really do wonderfully in their life, because it will coincide with their own being, how they will proceed over the next foreseeable future for themselves. And that's the concept of what teaching is really about. It's sure, you have to learn to drive properly, you have to walk properly, you have to do all those things. So the scales are important and the etudes are important and beautiful sound and how it works, but after that is really what it's about. And I think what we've done here is put in motion the IOS program, for example, the orchestral program.
The orchestral studies program.
Fantastic. I mean, it's amazing to do that. In today's world, in North America, with all its constriction.
That Institute for Orchestral Studies that Pinchas refers to is a unique program. Each year, 5 young players come to be mentored by members of the orchestra, and they also get to play with them, side by side, in some regular subscription concerts. It's an incredible opportunity for young talent to be nurtured by seasoned veterans. And then there's the NAC's Summer Music Institute, which is now an ambitious summer program of training players from all over the world, as well as young conductors and young composers. I asked orchestra violinist Elaine Klimasko about this. I mean, he's not just a great player and a conductor, but he's also a teacher, and he has this love for being with kids. It's amazing to watch, because he goes from being a superstar to being, I don't know, I sometimes think of him as Uncle Pinchas.
Well, I was going to say, that's very true what you just said, Eric, and I think of it as fatherly sometimes. I remember once we were, you know, sitting in the opera stage, and we were listening to some students on stage. I wanted him to hear a student of mine, and he turned around, and with all this exuberance, he looked at me and he said, "Elaine, isn't talent wonderful?"
Yeah.
Like, he's happy to hear talent. He's not threatened by it.
No.
I know people in their 60s who are threatened by fabulously talented younger people. And how silly is that? You know?
Right.
It's cyclic. I mean, you know, our time is not over, but I mean, because of my passion for teaching, I feel no intimidation by these young superstars in our orchestra. I mean, I think we make each other play better. They have our experience, we have their energy. And together, it's a perfect match. And I think one of the reasons the orchestra sounds as well as it does now and as good as it does now is because of that.
Now, that's interesting. So it's not just teaching kids as an education thing, but it's also helping the orchestra?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the Institute for Orchestral Studies, with which I'm quite involved, these kids are coming in. Well, they're not kids. I mean, some of them are doctoral students, whatever, but they're coming in and saying, you know, these experiences are just so important to them at this time, and it's helping them so much to gain confidence and experience to go on and to get a good job as soon as possible. And it's just with Pinchas, though, I mean, you think he's exhausted his ideas for education, and then, you know, he comes up to me a week later all enthusiastic. Hey, Wayne, I've got a great idea. He's got something else fantastic to share, something he wants to implement here, you know, to make this an education haven for, you know, orchestra musicians around the world. I think it's just so unselfish of him and so wonderful of him to be as committed as he is to this, because it's really, really important.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't exist in other places to this extent.
Elaine Clemasco, who's one of the original members of the National Arts Center Orchestra and still here playing. Here's one of Pinchas's young proteges, the Munich-born violinist Vivian Hagner, who in May 2005 came back to the NAC to play with the orchestra. This is the finale of the fiendishly difficult Violin Concerto No. 5 by Henri Vieuton. Violinist Vivian Hagner, dazzling in the Vieuton Violin Concerto No. 5 with a proud Pinchas Zukerman leading the National Arts Center Orchestra. Now, at the same time that Pinchas was charging ahead with his ambitious program of education, he was working on the acoustics of the hall, Southam Hall, which at his urging were improved significantly by an electronic system called ACS.
The one thing we changed dramatically is the acoustics. When we came on, I met a system in Jacksonville, Florida, and called ACS. And the ACS is an offshoot of Philips Records at the time. And they actually were coming to Halifax. Their main office became Canadian. So, hey, guess what? We can go and ask for some money. And Liz Waddell and Mitchell and a few others up on the hill saw the right. I really said, I can't do this in this kind of a hall. And so they put the ACS, and the ACS has been, so that's, ACS has been a lifesaver for chops, you know, for borms, for all sorts of things. We still get pains and stuff, but the sound, there's not even a comparison. There's no way to compare it. It's like sitting in the dark, and all of a sudden you get not only the light, but you get windows open.
Another advantage in having a virtuoso player as a music director: he knows how much good acoustics mean to the rest of the orchestra, to the players. But meantime, Pinchas was working on the orchestra itself. You can't have a string player of his caliber as a music director without him having a serious effect on the sound of the band. And so I asked his old friend, Itzhak Perlman, the other great violinist of their generation, whether he's heard a change in the sound of NACO in Pinchas's time.
Well, the sound of the orchestra is what he hears. And, Pinky has the most amazing sound, you know, I mean, not only on the violin, but of course, you've heard him play viola many, many times, and he's, you know, not only a great violinist, but a great viola player.
Right.
And he hears a particular way. And when you hear a particular way, orchestra plays a particular way. That's, you know, I think it's very simple. So when he conducts the strings and he hears what he hears in his head, that's what you hear in the string section. And or just basically not just the string section, but the whole orchestra. It's a question of what you have in your head, and that really it translates itself. It does. So the orchestra sounds beautiful.
So in a way, the orchestra echoes his sound.
Yeah.
What's in his head?
I think so. Yeah. I think so. I think that's what's supposed to happen, and that's what happens.
Itzhak Perlman. Now, pianist John Kimura Parker agrees. He's had the advantage of also playing chamber music with Pinchas, and that's given Jackie a new perspective on how the orchestra's sound has developed under Pinchas's leadership.
Hearing his sound that close and working with him in that light really made me understand pretty quickly what Pinchas has tried to do with the National Arts Center Orchestra, which is to really change their concept of sound. And that's a very different kind of approach that they are now experiencing than at any other time in their history, where richness of sound, bigness of concept, a kind of a large personality, which are all things that are part of Pinchas Zukerman, are things that he wants to be part of the orchestra. And that's probably been difficult for some of the players, and it's probably been very welcomed by many of the players, I would imagine. You know, it's a very different approach to what they've had. In a certain sense, although Pinchas has had a lot of experience with chamber orchestras, I mean, St. Paul Chamber Orchestra, he did much to create their sound. He likes a big sound, and I've suddenly gone from playing where I used to mostly play Mozart and Schumann and those kinds of works with NACO. I've now kind of graduated a little bit to works like the Beethoven Emperor and the Tchaikovsky and Rachmaninoff, and, you know, a slightly different type of repertoire,
right,
which in many cases has required more players.
John Kimura Parker. Another pianist, Yefim Bronfman, agrees about the change in the sound.
Oh, they're playing beautifully. You know, I just finished a rehearsal of Rachmaninoff Third Piano Concerto, which probably the piece they wouldn't even dream of playing 10, 15 years ago. But they have this lushness and beauty of sound that didn't have before. And, you know, I always say that the sound has a glow to it, you know, that something the orchestra didn't have it, but now they do have it.
Yefim Bronfman. Now, Pinchas himself is a little bit more elusive on that subject. I had to ask him about it several times before he responded directly to my question.
But I want to hold you to something. I mean, you have changed the string sound of the orchestra. They sound more like you.
Hey, you know why? Because I'm a string player. Hello.
I know.
No, that's everybody always says that. That's nonsense. It's because of the way I work. Yeah, absolutely. And what about the wind sound? You don't think I changed the wind sound? I think I have. It's because of hiring certain people and how we want that. And it's in the so-called principal secondary positions. I don't like to call it secondary positions because they're not. A second bassoon is not a secondary position. Oh, my God, if you don't have that bottom really properly, you're in deep doo-doo. So, and it's horns, it's a whole bunch of stuff. So, and it's intonation, it's working, it's constant moving around, all the stuff. Hey, let's do this, let's do that, let's create this, let's create that. I think there's more of a outgoing personality now to the orchestra. They ask more questions, maybe sometimes too many. But it's nice. It's a nice camaraderie. I think people like to say, hey, I hear this. Can we try that? Sure, let's do it. You know, where before it was, let's maybe not do that. So, you know, positions change. People come in. Sometimes it's better. Sometimes it's the same. So these are all very important things that go on in a lifetime.
Well, you've hired a lot of players over the 10 years. Young players have come in, veteran players, Chris Millar, Joel Quarrington, people like that. What do you look for in a player when you hire somebody into NAC?
How much they love hockey. If they don't like hockey, they can't come into this orchestra. That's it. It's
they got to talk hockey with you, dude.
And they don't have to be a Sens fan. You
they
know
don't?
What I mean? No, JQ, oh my God, he's still with the Leafs. But I think maybe he's swaying away. He's not going to become a Sens because he's very disappointed with how they play. And Chris... Well, Chris is a very good chef, by the way. Did you know that?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. So that's a criteria, very important to me. So I said, Chris, how about some dinner, you know? What do I look for? Oh, my God. I don't know, really. I think I look for Well, the ability, first of all, the talent, of course. The knowledge, the talent, the ability to change course very quickly, adjustability. If it's solo instrument, like with Chris Millard, you're looking for a solo personality in a way. But then also, how does he do things within the section? Because he's got to be one of 10 or 12 people that play together. How does that work with, well, you mentioned JQ, I mean, how does it work with that bass clef? Is it in tune? These are things that you instinctively, I think, hear. Knowing Chris, of course, over the years, I mean, there was not a big question mark in my head. And it takes for them still some time to adjust. I mean, even though he had been here a few times filling in, it takes some time to adjust to what's going on. But he's a fanatic about instruments, as you know. He builds things and he fixes things. And Kimball depends on Chris now for the clarinet, to fix his clarinet and things. So, and they're constantly, they themselves experiment. They look at, you know, the longer barrel, the shorter one, this reed, that reed. So these are all things that you get to know more as you're sitting and playing and working together. You get to know, they get to know me, of course, and I get to know them. And of course, we play chamber music. Forget it, I play a lot of chamber music with the wind players as well, with octets and septets and so on. So these are all, that's why the orchestra sounds different. It's not just because you work on the podium a certain way. Sure, those are very important elements. You've got to mark your parts. If you don't mark your parts, you're out of the ballpark as far as I'm concerned. No conductor should ever come to an orchestra without their parts. That's ridiculous. I mean, I have over 500 of my own pieces in the library here at the NAC. And Margot, God bless her, she's, and Greg, they fixed some of my old parts. And when they
patched them up?
Of course. in some cases, you know, did some redoing of stuff, because you can't, after you turn those pages so many times, you know, it becomes like toilet paper. You can't even touch it. It's, so it just falls apart. So
it's all scotch tape.
Yeah. And so they send parts of mine to other orchestras when I visit, those librarians, they say, oh, you're so lucky you got Margot and Greg. I said, tell me about it. So these are all parts of why the orchestra sounds different. I'm telling you, it's not one or two or three. It's a whole totality of stuff.
Pinchas Zukerman, bobbing and weaving on the question of how the sound of the National Arts Center Orchestra has changed and developed under his leadership. And in that answer, you hear a very important clue to Pinchas's leadership. It's direct, it's personal, it's visceral, and completely professional. There's a huge camaraderie to Pinchas's professional life, just as there is to his teaching life. He's a mensch, he's fully human, and he's right there with you. His most important hire has come recently. In June 2007, Pinchas appointed only the second concertmaster in the history of the orchestra. After music director, this is the most critical position in any orchestra. And after a long audition process, the National Arts Center Orchestra chose a young Japanese-American, age 30, named Yosuke Kawasaki. I put the question to Pinchas.
One of the most important decisions you've made is you've hired the second concertmaster in the history of this orchestra.
Correct.
And
what a concertmaster that is.
Yosuke Kawasaki.
I call him Yosele.
Yosele?
Yeah. It's the Jewish part of the Japanese, you know?
Right. That's the Yiddish way of pronouncing Japanese. What was it about him, personality, playing, that attracted you? Because it's a really important role.
His work ethic.
Really?
Forget the playing. The playing is obvious. It's the work ethic. You can tell immediately what he does. It's unbelievable. I'm lucky, in a way, because I've known his father for a very long time. Matao, and his mother, of course, as well. She was a wonderful flute player. Matao was Delay's assistant. He still teaches at Juilliard. He plays fantastic viola, his dad. So I didn't even know there was a son playing the violin. I was told that in Japan when I first was asking about somebody Japanese. Is there somebody I can, you know, audition and so on? And I was told that. And so his whole ability of being aware of what's going on, that's work ethic. It's not him. It's what's happening around him. And his discipline, his self-discipline on the instrument itself is... wonderful. And he's got a beautiful sound. It's just great. Just great. Lucky.
So revealing of Pinchas' personality as a music director. His need for the right chemistry in his relationship with an important player like the concertmaster, which is made up of family knowledge, recognition of work ethic, and his appreciation of how well this young man plays the violin. The one thing about Pinchas, and you've heard it in a number of comments throughout this program, he's incredibly generous in recognizing great talent in others, young or old, and quick to give others recognition and credit. Now, earlier, John Kimura Parker referred to the change in repertoire under Pinchas. Pinchas has enlarged the orchestra. He's done it through a clever combination of giving extra players a partial contract and benefits, so that while the core remains at about 50 players, he can also call on anywhere from 10 to 35 extra players when the repertoire demands it. And so Southam Hall has been hearing a lot more romantic repertoire under Pinchas. Dvorak, Mahler, and some of Pinchas' beloved Brahms. Pinchas Zukerman, leading the National Arts Center Orchestra in Brahms' Serenade No. 1 from a performance in June 2003. Such a track record of expansion and development in these first 11 years of Pinchas' time with the orchestra. But Pinchas is not just a big presence inside the National Arts Center. He looms large in the city of Ottawa itself. And I asked the NAC's CEO, Peter Herrendorf, what kind of an impact Pinchas has had in our capital city.
Well, I think that Ottawa is an unusual city in that the stars in Ottawa tend to be politicians. So the stars tend to be the Michael Ignatieffs and the Stephen Harpers and the Jean Chrétiens. What I like about the role that Pinchas has played is that in the last 10 years, the stars have been musicians and hockey players. So that... so that Daniel Alfredson from the Senators and Pinchas Zukerman from the National Arts Center are exciting figures in this community. This has always been a kind of a company town. This town is about politics. And what I love about the role that Pinchas plays and the role that Wajdi Muawad and Peter Hinton and Kathy Levy play and the hockey players is that. It adds a kind of texture to this community that makes it much more interesting. People now talk about coming to Ottawa as a cultural destination. You, Eric Friesen, came to Ottawa to create a wonderful show about classical music. And so, to some degree, Pinchas has been a catalyst in changing the way that Ottawa sees itself and I think the way the rest of the country sees Ottawa.
Peter Herrendorf. Now, Pinchas talked earlier of his love for Canada and of his attraction to the city of Ottawa to make his home here. A little later in our conversation, he made the point that the pluses of living in Canada and Ottawa actually contribute significantly to the health of music making here at the NAC.
You know, living in Canada lends itself to elbow room. And for the life of me, I don't know why. Every time I come back from somewhere touring, I feel, I got time. It's the same hour.
Time and space.
Space in
time?
Sort of in a kind of horizontal way.
Well, it's big country, few people. I mean, is that
maybe? Also, the elements. Don't forget, the elements bring you more to understand what maybe that person down the street needs, even if they're not asking.
More somehow, sense of community, you mean?
Maybe. There's something about that. It's not the, you know, when I tell people, you know, we had 5 feet of snow, they go, what? I said, yeah, but you know, it's amazing how beautiful it is. They go, how can that be beautiful? I said, well, you got to come and see it. How do you explain that? Or when the light in the middle of the night, you know, when you see the light now, it stays up. I mean, of course, now spring is coming, so you have light till 8 o'clock already. When you see that moon and coming up and the sunset has just happened and you go, whoa. Now, I'm sure there are other places that have the same. But maybe in New York, you can't see it because those damn high-rises, you know? You only think of these poor people in these elevators, and they're going back to a cubicle. There ain't much room there. It's an island, you know? So, and that's what I know. I lived there for so many years. So it's a good feeling. It's a very, very good feeling. Not that I would want to live in prairie land. I mean, that's not my wish in life. I mean, I don't want to live in some farm. I mean, I don't have that ambition. Besides, I wouldn't know what to do with a cow anyhow. So, you know, I mean, I'd play a few scales. Moo, you know, a moon river, that's it. But it's kind of amazing. And I think we forget how lucky we are. Also, the beauty of the city. I think there's a very beautiful city. Some people call it European. What's European? You know, just because it's beautiful, you call it European? You know, I call it Little Ben, you know, the clock here. But
you nobody, mean in the Peace Tower?
Yeah, nobody ever thinks of it as Little Ben, only me. They say, well, you're crazy. It's not Little Ben, it's a clock. I said, okay, it's a clock. They ain't Little Susie. So, you know, we have changing of the guards. It's not exactly the same, but, you know, what the hell? So it does remind you a little bit of that English thing, which I like personally.
Yeah, because you've had a lot of relationship too.
Right? Yeah, so anyway, it's very nice. I like it.
As I sit and listen to you, it's almost like you become poetic. You tell me you never speak in poetry, but you do. You just did.
That's poetry? Oy vey. Ezra Pound, I ain't.
Well, not Ezra Pound. More Wordsworth.
Not even
lyrical.
Steven. No, lyrical. Yeah, maybe. Well, sometimes it's okay. Well, you bring it out in me, you know.
Now, I let that part of our conversation go on a little bit because it gives you a better sense of the way Pinchas thinks, that peripheral vision of his taking in his complete surroundings in describing his successes in Ottawa and always deflecting away from himself to give full credit to the complex web of people and circumstances that make up his life as music director of the National Arts Center Orchestra. Pinchas also gives great credit to the administrative leadership of the NAC, to the man who was board chair during much of Pinchas's time in Ottawa, David Leighton, and to the CEO most of that time, and who still is, Peter Herrendorf. Pinchas begins by talking about what Peter Herrendorf has meant to this fourth decade of the NAC.
I think he's been amazing coming in here and giving the confidence to all of us that we can do it. That's a unique ability. And again, we're very fortunate to have had David Leighton that understood that. When Mitchell said, David, you're going to become the chairman, he had to come out of retirement, whatever that meant. It didn't mean a thing. He wanted to do it anyway.
Right.
But he always said, oh, I have to come out of retirement. I don't know if I can do it with Peggy coming back and with Banff and this and that and our kids and the grandkids. And bingo, the next thing he did, says, I think I have the person out to run it as CEO. And sure enough. So he came, and one of the first things he did, I remember, he met with all sorts of groups of people, and he said, I want to hear from you. I want to listen to what you have to say. And that's a great gift.
It is.
That's music. That's music making. So it works hand in hand. It's good.
It's not just good. I can say it. It's been a fantastic run of 11 years so far when you fill in the whole picture.
In fact, CEO Peter Herrendorf makes the case that this time, right now, is the best it's ever been for the orchestra.
Even though those days in 1969 and 70 and 71 were heady days, I would make the argument that probably the best times for the National Arts Center Orchestra have been in the last few years. I think this has been a kind of golden age for the National Arts Center Orchestra. And as nice as it is to be nostalgic about 69 and 70 and 71, if you look at some of the things that the orchestra has been doing in recent years, I think you'll have a sense that the orchestra has really been going through that kind of a positive period.
Peter Herrendorf. It's a positive period that still has an unwritten ending. We've come to 40 years in the life of this orchestra, from a magical beginning to some great mountains and some deep valleys over the decades to now. But the Pinchas years are not yet finished. I asked him how long he might still be here in Ottawa with the National Arts Center Orchestra. And in his usual way, Pinchas wandered around the question here and there, and then came to a musical image and answering my question in the way that only he does.
In a way, I think I'm very lucky because I've got the C major scale that goes right around, and it's perfect circle. It comes right back to the beginning. So that's lucky for me. I'm very lucky, and I still can do it on my own without interference from somewhere else. So I feel very fortunate, and I think that's why sometimes I'm hard-nosed or adamant about aspects. And what happened, I think, here for me mainly is people really wanted to listen to that and want to be part of it, and that's great. So I've had a fantastic journey. And how long will it take to get off that journey? As long as I can hear and do what I need to do, I'll stick around. And I don't know if it's 2 years or 4 years or 6 years. I have no idea. I don't know. But we'll see. It certainly has nothing to do with monetary, I tell you. Nothing to do with money. People always think, well, he's making so much money. You know, he's going to stay because he's making so much money. Ah, rubbish. You know, so I think there is a divine aspect and comedy at the same time. And I want to finish by telling you a story that Moses apparently is a joke, kind of. Moses apparently had a stutter, and there's a biblical town called Canaan. I mean, in English it's pronounced Canaan. And when he got the tablet, you know, all the Ten Commandments, God said, hey, Moshele, where do you want to go now? He says, I want to go to, you want to say Canada, and he came out with Canaan. There you are. So here I am.
So here you are in Canada. Canada.
Pinchas Zukerman, still here in the promised land, and it sounds like he'll be here for some time to come. And while he laughs, he worries about the effect of this current recession on the future of the orchestra and on the future of classical music around the world. But for a man who's come through tougher times, as did his parents before him, he knows that he'll still always have the music and will still always be giving us the music at its highest level.
Thank you.
Pinchas Zukerman leading the National Arts Center Orchestra in the finale from Sergei Rachmaninoff's Symphony No. 2 that was at Southam Hall, September 2004. You can hear all the music that we've been listening to on this program and more, the complete performances, some 150 live recorded performances by the National Arts Center Orchestra, and here's how you can hear them. You go to the artsalive.ca website, artsalive.ca, and register to the NACO Music Box, and that's where you'll be able to access these live recorded musical performances. On the next program, I'll be looking at the national part of the mandate of the National Arts Center Orchestra. Very important. Touring across Canada, broadcasting, commercial recording, the internet, and the orchestra's commitment to Canadian composers. I'm Eric Friesen. Stay in touch. It's good to know that you're out there listening.